today's video, we'll be going over thermal dissipation, otherwise known as thermals, and how to handle the excess heat being dissipated by LDOs. A low dropout regulator's nature is to regulate a voltage by changing the resistance in the pass element. When looking at the power delivered in an LDO, it can be calculated as Vout times Iout. The power into the LDO can be calculated as VIN times IN. As you may know, in a linear regulator, the input current and the output current of the LDO are equal if the ground current is neglected. So if the input and the output voltage are not equal, all of the remaining power is being dissipated in the LDO. This results in the remaining power being turned into heat. The thermal performance of an LDO is a metric of how well the packaged part transfers heat from the die to the PCB. If the package is not able to dissipate power well enough, the die will heat up and cause the part to enter thermal shutdown. If the power being dissipated is not properly handled, the device will cycle in and out of thermal shutdown and will degrade long-term device reliability. At Texas Instruments, the thermal numbers specified in the datasheet adhere to the JESD 5.1 standard. One advantage of doing thermal models to this standard is that devices can easily be compared to other devices that were modeled using this standard. Parts that were not modeled using this standard will not be able to be directly compared to the TI parts. As part of the JESD 5.1 standard, we give 5 thermal metrics, theta JA, theta JC top, theta JB, psi JT, psi JB, and theta JC bottom. The most commonly used of these metrics is theta JA, which is used to calculate the junction temperature based on the ambient temperature. To use theta JA in your application, there are only 2 parameters you need to know, ambient temperature and power dissipation. You should use the worst case ambient temperature for your calculations. Power dissipation can be calculated as VIN minus VOUT times IOUT plus VIN times IGROUND. Once you have these parameters, you can plug them into the equation for TJ and get the worst case junction temperature. Although theta JA is one of the most useful metrics, there are also some limitations. One limitation of theta JA is it is a measure of thermal performance of an IC mounted on the JEDEC PCB. This means the number would only apply to a specific board layout. The reason that theta JA is still so commonly used is that ambient temperature is one of the only parameters that system designers have access to. When dealing with LDOs, you are not able to assume that the board temperature is the same as the ambient temperature because the LDO is dissipating power, causing the board temperature to rise. There are several key parameters that have a large effect on theta JA. PCB design and layout, as well as the thermal pad size, have the largest effect on theta JA. The amount of power being dissipated and the ambient temperature have little to no effect on theta JA, as they don't greatly alter the heat transfer. As previously mentioned, PCB design and thermal pad size have the largest effect on theta JA. As a result of this, different packages have different levels of thermal performance. The worst packages thermally are leaded packages that do not have a thermal pad touching the board, like the SOT23. When comparing the SOT23 to a much smaller X2 SOM package, which is 1x1 mm, you can see that the theta JA is increased by almost 50 C per watt just by not having the thermal pad. Once you have gone from the leaded packages without thermal pads to QFNs, a part with a bigger thermal pad will have a better theta JA. This makes sense intuitively, as increasing the size of the object would cause it to heat up slower. This can be seen by comparing the X2 SOM package to the SON. Going from a 1x1 mm package to a 2x2 mm package with a bigger thermal pad reduces the theta JA by approximately 70 C per watt. You can see how big of an impact using the correct package can make in your system. As previously discussed, the thermal parameters are highly dependent on the board layout that is used. TI LDO thermal metrics are modeled using the JEDEC High K board, which is 2S, 2P, 2 signal, 2 power planes. The JEDEC board has 2 internal planes that have approximately 5,500 millimeters squared of 1 ounce copper. This is to mimic the common applications where they have 1 ground and 1 power plane. As a result, only 1 of these planes is connected to the thermal vias that are connected to the die. The bottom layer has approximately 1,100 millimeters squared of 2 ounce copper, and it is connected to the thermal pad through the thermal vias. The top layer consists only of traces which go to the pins of the device. One way to improve the thermal performance of your board is to add a top ground layer that connects to the thermal pad. Adding additional vias to this ground plane will also help improve the thermal performance. It's not realistic to expect everyone to comply with the rules set in the JEDEC standard, so I want to leave you with some final considerations when it comes to thermals. In your system, you will likely have nearby components that will cause the board to heat up. This is important to consider, as the JEDEC boards only have the single IC populated. Another common misconception is that pulsing the load will always reduce the thermal strain on the LDO. Pulsing the load may still cause the LDO to heat up if the duty cycle is too high or the pulse lengths are too long. This can cause the LDO to go into thermal shutdown. To avoid thermal shutdown, only pulse the load for tens of milliseconds and then leave the LDO off an equal or greater amount of time to cool off. The final thing to do in every layout of an LDO is to connect as much copper as possible to the LDO thermal pad. This will increase the size of the heatsink and can reduce the theta J shown in the datasheet by up to 25%. Also, be sure to place an array of thermal vias around the LDO to assist in removing heat from the LDO. Thank you all for watching. For more information on LDOs, check out our page at ti.com/LDO, or go visit the LDO Basics blog and video series by going to the Support and Training tab on the LDO page.